my seat, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. Psalms 27:4. Please hear the prayer. Dear Lord, we're just so grateful that we can be here in your house and that we can worship you in a country that allows us to be free enough to not worry about anything happening to us, that we can just praise you and honor you and hold you up, Lord, that we can bring others to you. And may we just always be honoring you and do what is right in your name.
Yeah. Oh, Morning. I recently got progressive glasses and I found out I'm not a progressive, so bear with me. I'd like to ask a question today as we come around this time that we partake of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. I'd like to ask the question, who's your king? I'd like to go to John chapter 18 if you have your Bibles and look at the conversation that Jesus had with Pilate. And then we'll roll into the first part of 19, and I promise, Joey, I won't eat up a lot of your sermon time here. John 18, starting out in verse 33, says, "Therefore Pilate entered the praetorium again and summoned Jesus and said to him, 'You are the king of the Jews?' Jesus answered, 'Are you saying this on your own, or did others tell you about me?'" Jesus is obviously wondering if, and I doubt if he's wondering, he already knows because he knows everything, but he's asking the question, did you come up with that on your own, or did the religious leaders who have me up in front of you, did they tell you that? But I think if you look at that, and as I read and study the word, I get hung up on things, and maybe I'm just hung up on this, and the religious scholars we have here can get after me afterwards. I think when we look at Jesus' words here, we should apply them to ourselves as well. So the question here for us would be, did we find Jesus on our own, or did others tell us about him? And I think if you look at the world, a lot of people, unfortunately, are finding Jesus on their own and are getting the wrong idea about who Jesus is. The Great Commission tells us that as Christians, it's our job to go out and tell people about Jesus Christ. And that way, hopefully, they'll get a more accurate picture. But back to the story here, Pilate says, "I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would be fighting so that I would not be handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not of this realm." And I'm thankful for that. This world we live in is just a terrible mess and getting worse. Verse 37, "Therefore Pilate said to him, 'So you are a king.' Jesus answered, 'You say correctly that I am a king. For this purpose I have been born, and for this I have come into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice.'" So I ask again, who's your king? Jesus said that he is a king, and he's not of this realm. Is he your king? He also says in that verse that he testifies to the truth, and everyone who is of the truth listens to his voice. Pilate had a question about that. What is the truth? That's a question that needs to be answered and asked over and over again in this world we live in. What is the truth? We need to be seeking the truth in all things, but mostly we need to be seeking the truth in what God's will is for us. Pilate, like many people, asked a good question. What's the truth? If you read on, Pilate did not stay and did not care to hear the truth. And that's the sad shape of our world today. Not many care to hear what the truth really is. After saying this, he came out again to the Jews and said to them, "I find no grounds at all for charges in his case. However, you have a custom that I release one prisoner for you at the Passover. Therefore, do you wish that I release for you the king of the Jews?" So they shouted again, saying, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a rebel. And it sounds like, and a lot of commentaries want to make Pilate out here to be a man caught in the middle. He doesn't find any grounds to arrest Jesus, and he's just a good guy looking for a way out. But I want to tell you, Pilate's not a good guy in this case. He's not a good guy, period. History proves that out. He was pretty ruthless. He was just trying to keep himself out of trouble with Rome. He's not really interested in much else. And also probably trying to stay in good graces with his wife, who warned him not to have anything to do with Jesus. He should have listened to that. Chapter 19, then, it starts out, "So Pilate then took Jesus and had him flogged." You know, he didn't find any grounds for any basis of charges, but he was more than happy to have Jesus flogged. And this flogging would have been horrible. Some people died under this kind of flogging that the Romans gave. And when Jesus came back out, there probably wasn't a square inch of his body that didn't have blood covering it. He would have been in horrible shape. In fact, I'll read a little bit about that to you here in a little bit. But so he had him flogged, and the soldiers, verse 2 of 19, twisted together a crown of thorns and placed it on his head and put a purple cloak on him. Obviously, the purple is a symbol of royalty back in that day, so they're making fun of him being a king. And they repeatedly came up to him and said, "Hail, King of the Jews," and slapped him in the face again and again. And then Pilate came out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you so that you will know that I find no grounds at all for charges in his case." Jesus then came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." Now, if you read the account of the crucifixion of Jesus, starting in about John 18, from the time he was arrested till the end of 19 when he's crucified and died, you can read that in about 20 minutes. This was hours of time that has passed, and I think sometimes we miss how bad that really was for Jesus. Now, the Passion of the Christ came out, what, probably 15, 20 years ago now. And it tried to depict what that was like, and it was horrible to watch that movie. That movie lasted about an hour and a half. This would have been hours, over hours of time that this took place. Isaiah, when Pilate said, "Behold the man," Isaiah in chapter 52 said, "See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted. Just as there were many who were appalled at him, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any human being, and his form marred beyond human likeness." That's what they would have been looking at when he was brought out, and they said, "Behold the man." But if you know the rest of the story, it did not affect them. Here they are looking at a man that's beaten beyond recognition, bloody. He's been claimed innocent by Pilate twice. And they still yell, "Crucify him, we have no king but Caesar." So again, I ask you, who's your king? And I think we need to think about those things. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 7, it says, "Behold," in John 19 it says, "Behold the man." In Revelation 1:7 it says, "Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn over him. So it is to be. Amen." Why are they mourning? Why are they mourning over him? Well, if you go to Revelation 6:15, it sheds a little light on that. "Then the kings of the earth, the princes, the generals, the rich, the mighty, and everyone else, both slave and free, hid in caves and among the rocks of the mountains. They called to the mountains and the rocks, 'Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of their wrath has come, and who can withstand it?'" You need to pick your king, and that king needs to be Jesus, because he is sitting on his throne, and he is coming back for those that are prepared. For those that are not, they're going to try to hide. It's not going to work, and it's not going to be a good day for them. Think upon these things for a minute. Thank you. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for all the blessings that you give us. And Lord, we're thankful that you came to earth to show us the way. It's hard to read about your death, burial, and resurrection. Now, the resurrection is the highlight of that event, but the beating and everything that you took because of our sins to reconcile us back to God is a hard read. And Lord, I pray that my brothers and sisters in Christ, along with me here, Lord, would keep our focus and keep you king of our lives. And we're thankful, Lord, that you came not only to be a king of our lives, but our Savior to save us from our sins. And I pray at this time, Lord, as we partake of these emblems, that we would not only proclaim the death to your death to the world until you come again, Lord, but that we would keep our hearts in line with what you would have us to do. Lord, help us proclaim the gospel message to all those that we meet. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. On the night he was betrayed, he took the bread and broke it and said, "This is my body." In the same manner, he took the cup and said, "This is the blood of the covenant for the remission of sins."
Good morning. We're going to pray for our offering today. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear Lord, as we come right now, we lift up our offering. Lord, we thank you so much for everything you have blessed us with, everything you've given to us. Lord, as fall comes and harvest comes in, we thank you for all of that. And as we say thank you, we come, Lord, ready to give back. And in our offering, we give our financial back to you, Lord. But also we come, Lord, giving you our time and our energy and our focus. And Lord, I pray for those of us who are here to glorify you and to worship you and to learn more about you. Lord, we come ready to learn. We come with our eyes open and our hearts wide, ready to see what you have to say. And Lord, we pray your Spirit not only show us your word and what you mean, but also, Lord, convict us into action. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. In our series, Why Do We Do That?, we've been looking at the reason God has passed to us these different traditions through his apostles, and he's told us to hold firm to these. These are traditions that we are to hold firm to. And as I got to thinking about it, we've studied prayer and reading the Bible so far. And as I was looking at them, one thing I've noticed is while we may not always do those things, we may have times that we sit there and we struggle and we go, well, I don't know. I don't want to do it. I know I should, but we don't always do it. But we always come back to, I know it's important to pray. I know it's important to read the Bible. And we never really try to get out of it. We just don't do it, right? But here's what's interesting. The one we're going to look at today is a little bit different. All right, I want to show you a comic strip. If you see this comic strip, it says, "I don't feel like going to church today. I'll just make it up to the man upstairs another way." Can you lend me your credit card before you leave? And as you can see on the TV, it is a televangelist, and she's going to make it up by giving more money instead of going to church. And the mother says, "Nice try. Get in the car. We're going to be late." Hey, how many of you remember, especially as a kid, trying to get out of going to church? You would do anything to get out of, maybe even fake being sick to get out of going to church, right? And throughout the years, we've seen kids do this, but more and more we're seeing adults trying to get out of church. But what I've noticed is it's not just trying to get out of church by just missing a Sunday But over the last several decades, people aren't just trying to skip. They're actually coming up with arguments as to why church isn't necessary or important. That church is just a thing you do. You don't have to do that. It's not that big of a deal. And I really got to thinking about it, and I looked up and thought through different excuses people have given me, different excuses people have given other ministers and other people. And what I discovered is for every excuse somebody has about why church isn't important, God has a response to every single one of them. So I'm going to list a couple of them off real quick. One of them is church is man-made. It's a man-made thing. And in Matthew 16, 18, it says, on this rock, and this is Jesus speaking, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. So who started building the church? Who implemented it? Jesus. Not, I mean, he was a man, but he was also God. So technically man-made, but this is Jesus and God saying, I am building the church. God has started this. Then the other thing you hear is Christianity is an individual thing, not a corporate thing. It's my faith. It's all about me and Jesus. All the other people in the room don't matter. I don't have to go there to worship God. I can go out into Mother Nature, into the woods, and I can just worship God. That's all I need. Give me a tree and a rock to sit on, and that's all I need for church. 1 Peter 2:5 says this, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. What's it say? You, like living stones, are being built. We are all being built together. So the church isn't an individual thing. It's everybody together. Okay, so we all have to be together. But it never says to go to church. We can be together by just talking to each other on the phone, right? We can just write letters to each other. We don't have to all be together. But Hebrews 10:25, the first part of it says this, do not give up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing. So what does it say? Continue meeting together, continue assembling. Obviously, God has designed the church for all of us who are Christians to assemble together in worship to Him. But there's a question that still remains. And this is a question that I think parents, you need to know, grandparents, you need to know. And for each of you in this room, I'm going to ask you this question. Why are you in church? Why do you need to be here? Do you need to be here? Is it just a box? What is the purpose for us being here today? Parents, what do you say when your kid says, I don't want to go to church today? Do you tell them, I don't care, suck it up and come anyways? That's what my mom made me do. You've got to do it too. Is that the response? No. Why do we do this? Besides, God tells us to. Hebrews 10, 19 through 39, the author of Hebrews, which we are not sure who it was exactly, but what he does do is he calls Christians to persevere in faith. And in verses 19 through 22, he talks about how communion and baptism help us do this, and we will look at that next week. But what I want to look at today, as he continues on in verses 23 and 25, he explains how we need to continue meeting and being a part of the church to be able to persevere. And that being one of the purposes is in order for us to persevere as Christians, we need to meet together. And today, through the author's explanation of why we are not to forsake the meeting together, we're going to see three ways of how being active in the church helps to unite us as Christians in Christ. And I want to point this out, and we're going to look at this more in depth, but just because you're sitting in the pew doesn't mean you are assembling. If you're here and sitting in a pew, you might be at the church building, but I want to talk about what it means to be part of the church. The question actually probably should be not why do we go to church, but why are we a part of the church regularly? Let's begin in Hebrews 10:23 for this first reason. It says this, "Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful." First reason we come to church, first reason we are a part of the church, is to support each other, to stand firm in the gospel. The author stresses that we need to hold on to the hope we have in Christ. Notice when he says hold on to the hope, he doesn't just say hold on to it and never let go. He says hold on unswervingly. The idea behind this word in the Greek is an object that stands straight up and never bends to the left or to the right. You see, I think sometimes we think holding on to our faith means you can stand up, but when the wind blows, you can lean this way a little bit as long as you come back to the middle. When the wind blows, you can go this way, but you come back to the middle. No, this word unswervingly means not bending one way or the other, staying straight. That's what we are called to do. During this time, when this book is written in the book of Hebrews, the church has been being persecuted and Jews are coming in and trying to convince the Jewish Christians that they made a mistake. And this caused some of them to waver and let go of the hope they had in Jesus. And a lot of them were starting to walk away from the faith. As we're going to see, some of them quit meeting together. As I got to thinking about that, don't we still see this today? This is a thing that wasn't just back then. It still happens now. When discouragements happen, they start to bring up doubts, right? Maybe the doubts of who God is. Maybe the doubts are whether it's worth it to follow God. Maybe it's, did Christ even come to save me? Or is Christ even going to save me? Is he going to come back? I heard the question asked this morning, can you tell me exactly when Jesus is coming back to save us? And for some, if you can't tell me that answer, is he really coming back? Now, I will say the person who talked to this other person gave a really good answer on that we don't know. But that's why we're prepared. But you see, a lot of times when these things start to creep in, what happens? What's the first thing that normally happens? We start to go to church less and less. We start to pull away from Christian people, and then all of a sudden we start to pull away from God, and then completely we turn our back and walk away from Jesus completely and go back to our old way of sins. And often this happens because we try to hold tight on our own, right? We try to hold on and we try to go through just doing it by ourselves. I don't need anybody else. And here's the deal. There are some people that come into the church building and still do that. You may be sitting here, but you don't let anybody else hold you or help you. And here's what I want to encourage you. Notice at the beginning of verse 23, let us hold unswervingly. Let us. It is a corporate thing. God has designed his church so that when we assemble, we can support each other and stand firm in the hope of the gospel together. When doubts and temptations creep in and try to bend us, we have each other to hold each other up. And this is what Galatians 6:1-2 says. It says, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. We need to be bearing with each other, bearing one another's burdens, coming alongside and helping each other out. We need to look more like the example that God gives us in the musk ox. I love that name, the musk ox. Now, here's something interesting about a musk ox. You see, these are big creatures, right? And you would think if a wolf comes, they could handle a wolf on their own. But what happens with wolves? They hunt in packs. And several of them could take down one musk ox on its own. But what the musk ox does when danger is near The herd forms a circle with their heads and horns outward, and they put the young and the weak in the center, and they gather together for mutual protection. And whenever a wolf attacks, if you notice in the picture, there are several of them there to stop the wolves. It's a lot harder for wolves to take down a group of them than it is to take down them individually. This is the same thing with the church, and the first church understood this. In Acts 2:42, this is the image we're given of the church. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. This is why some of us are at church whenever the doors are open. See, some of you may sit there and some of you kids may go, why does mom and dad always have to be at church 3 or 4 times a week? Why is it they're there all the time? And some of you may even sit there and go, why do they want us to be at church so much? Because when we're together and we are talking to each other and we are praying together and we are teaching and learning and breaking bread, when we're doing all of this, we should be holding each other up. And in a world that we live in today, we need it more than ever. And you see, when we do prayer requests and we pray for each other, we do a really good job of praying for each other here. I will tell you that prayer request list can last for an hour if we wanted it to, right? But it's because we really care about each other. We want to hear what's going on, but here's the deal. When we do prayer requests, it shouldn't just be what's physically wrong with us or someone else. We should be praying for each other spiritually. And you know what I love? I've got several of you who will come and say, hey, can you pray for this spiritual issue? Can you pray for this? And you know what you're doing? You're asking someone else to help hold you up. And when they pray with you and come alongside of you, they hold you up. And you see, when we study God's word and we all come together and we're reading God's word, and this is why we do the sermons on Sundays, because we can come in and we point each other back to Christ. When life gets tough, we point each other back to Christ. And someone asked me, Joey, why do you go to so many Bible studies in a week? Is it because you're the preacher? No, because every time I go to Bible study, it points me back to Christ. And in a world we live in today where everything points away and is dragging you down, and if all you did was watch the news, you would be the most depressed person in the world, which is why there is so much depression in this world. I need pointed back to Christ as much as possible. And having other people who come alongside me and say, let's all look to Christ together, it is such a blessing. That's one of the reasons why I come to church. Because we're pointing each other back to God, because he is the one who promised, and we know he's faithful. As Hebrews 10:23 ends, for he who promised is faithful. That's the whole thing. I want us to remember that it's not each other that save each other or bring peace to each other. We're there to help each other look to the one who brings peace. It's God who brings peace and comfort and holds us up, but he's given us each other to guide each other back that direction. And once we do this and we can stand firm in the gospel together, we can fulfill the next reason why we come to church in Hebrews 10:24. Let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Second reason we come to church, to push each other to show the love of Christ. One of the excuses that gets used often for not going to church or leaving a church is, I don't get anything out of it. I have heard that so often. Joey, I went to church, but the music isn't what I like. It doesn't speak to me. It's not my type of music. Or the sermon or the teaching isn't my style. I went to one church and they were just kind of a boring preacher. I didn't like it. I couldn't learn anything because of who he was. Can I ask you a question? is the reason we go to church, is the reason we listen to a speaker, is the reason why we go and worship God, is it about us? No. I've also heard people say, the church doesn't have the type of ministries I like, or they don't do things the way I like them, or in the order that I want them done. Oof. Here's the thing, though. How many of us have thought those things before? I know I have. I've been there where I've been to a church, especially in my younger years in college. I would pick and choose a church and left several churches and church hopped for a while because I couldn't find the church that spoke to me. And you know what I was doing? I was making church all about myself. And when we begin to only think about how much church can serve us, you know what? You will never find a church where you are happy. You know why? Because that's not the purpose why God designed the church in the first place. If you're looking for your own personal happiness, you will never find it if that's all you're seeking out, because God didn't put the church here for that purpose. Hebrews says we need to be considering or thinking about others. The first point is to point each other to Christ. That's the first reason for church. The other reason is for us to think about others. And that word for consider is to deeply ponder about, not just in passing. Oh, I wonder how John's doing today. Oh, I hope he's doing good. Okay, good. John, how are you doing today? Good. Okay. All right. No, it's literally to sit there and think, how can I help this person? Not just when I see their face sitting at home, how can I help them? When we're in public, when we're at church, how can I help others and spur them on? Paul explains this in Philippians 2, 3 through 4. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interest of others. And I think when we read that, we think interests. Okay, what does the word interest mean? So I should do what makes other people happy. No, that's not what Hebrews says. It actually gives a better definition of interest in Hebrews 10:24. It says, let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. That word for spur in the Greek means to provoke or push someone. It actually basically means to pester. How can I push and pester someone to a point where they want to show love? To a point where they want to look more like Christ. And some of you may be sitting there going, oh, no, don't say that. Please don't go there, Joey. I'm personal. I have my private space. Nobody else comes in my bubble. I don't go in their bubble. That's their personal lives. I've got my personal life. Joey, you're asking us to get way too close here. Next thing, you're going to have us hold hands and sing Kumbaya and give each other kisses when we come to church. It's a holy kiss. No, I'm not going there. But we are called to think about how can we push each other? How can we help each other come alongside and say, hey, how are you showing God's love? Well, what does it look like to push? What does this pushing look like? And I will tell you, I have in our church seen this happen in several ways, and I love it. One of those ways is simply, and some of you get annoyed by this, I know, but I'm going to put it out there for you anyways. Some of you put out posts on Facebook and on social media about verses you're reading, but you don't stop at just read this verse. You explain what it means and encourage people. How can you do this? You push people, but then some of you get a little more personal with it. You ready? And I know one of you in particular does this, and there are several others too, but you send out text messages. Sometimes it's a joke, lift up, but sometimes it's a Bible verse. And it's a thought-provoking Bible verse, and it's an encouragement to think about and to push the other people in this text group to take this and apply it. Simple, right? But I know for the people that get those texts, It is the most encouraging thing of their day, and this lady will do it two or three times a day. Is that hard to do? That's something we all could be doing, right? Here's another way that we can push each other. Is by not just doing that, maybe we write notes to each other. There are some that do now, and I know in our past in our church, who write notes of encouragement, but also notes of keep pressing on and Bible scriptures that encourage on how to show love and go deeper. Maybe another way is getting plugged into a small group that says, hey, let me invite someone to our small group, to our Bible study. Maybe I need to get plugged into it so that I can come alongside and we can talk at the small group and encourage each other. Or maybe it's talking after church or before church. A lot of you do that, which is fantastic. But here's the catch of that. Again, this is pushing each other towards love and good works in Christ. I'm not just talking sit around and talk about football, all right? Sit around and talk about gardening, your lawn, the list goes, your grandkids, any of that, the trip you just took. Those are good things to talk about, and please do. But in each of your conversations, how are you talking about? Are you asking, hey, how can I pray for you? Hey, how are you doing spiritually? Hey, what did you study in your Bible this week? You know what I've learned when you ask that question? The first time they may tell you, I didn't read this week. The next week you go and see them and say, hey, what'd you study in your Bible this week? You know what? They always have an answer. Why? Because you've pushed them into looking more like Christ. Love and good works. And some of you may be going, okay, Joey, I get that, but there is part of going to church is about us, right? We do need to focus on us. We do need to grow spiritually, right? Yes, but think of this. If everybody is going around and pushing each other, then that means someone else is pushing you too. That if the church is doing what it's supposed to, if it looks like it's supposed to, then everybody is pushing each other, and we are all pushing, and while I'm pushing you, you're pushing me to show good works also. As Proverbs 27:17 says, as iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. When we quit making church about us and make it a priority to help others grow in Christ, then what you'll notice is you'll want to meet together more. Because it'll be an environment of encouragement and uplifting, and it actually will lead us into the third purpose of the church in Hebrews 10:25. Here's that verse again. Not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Encouraging each other to persevere. That's why we go to church. The author here says it's important to meet together as Christ's church. We don't need to let life get in the way. Right? That's what happens a lot too, isn't it? Why did you miss the last several weeks of church? Well, we wanted to do this, or there was this family outing, or there was this or that, and all of a sudden, we just lost sight of it, and we missed church for a couple weeks. Well, here's what I encourage you. You ready? And I had one person tell me, well, Joey, what if you're telling me not to go on vacation ever? No. But when you go on vacation, are there churches? In other places? Is it just this church that you're loyal to? No, you're loyal to God's church. We are all Christians and all part of the church. Wherever you go, find a good Bible preaching church. Go there. And as you go, do these things with them. Go to encourage each other. Go to support them and to talk to them about what God's doing here and find out what God's doing in that church. You know what I love to hear? And there's one guy that does this in our church. Actually, he's one of our elders. He will, when he goes on vacation, go to different churches. And when he comes back, I get a phone call. And he tells me about his vacation. But the other thing he always tells me is, he tells me the church he went to, the people he met, and what God's doing at that church. And it encourages me. Not just because he was in church, but I'm hearing what God's doing in other churches. I'm seeing how God's working. We should be doing the same. Doesn't matter when. We need to be meeting together, but not just meeting together. We need to be encouraging each other every time we get together. This is why God has given each of us different gifts in the church, to use them to serve and love each other. 1 Corinthians 14:26, "What then, brothers? When you come together, each one has a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. Let all things be done for building up." Everything we do, and if God's given you a spiritual gift, the purpose of using it in the church is so that you can help build others up. I will tell you, for me personally, when I see someone leading worship, when I see somebody teaching, preparing meals, driving a bus, spending time with the kids or the teenagers, going around, and even when I watch a kid help an older person down and walk with them or even push them, I see all of that, and it is the most encouraging thing to me. If you're an adult, it encourages me too. But kids are cuter when they do it. But when I see all of this, it encourages me to keep pushing. It lets me know that I'm not the only one trying to look like Christ. And as Christ's return gets closer and the world gets crazier, I know I have others around me who are following Christ too and using the gifts God gave them also. That is a huge encouragement, and it builds me up. It builds others up. And as we continue to use those gifts, we each mutually build each other up into what Christ wants. We all need to be encouraged, don't we? Isn't that the one thing that brightens your day the most, is when someone comes and encourages you? But you see, it's not just being encouraged by building each other up through using gifts. We also need to do it by how we talk to each other. And I'll say our church is one of the most loving and caring churches. You can ask anyone who walks into this church. They feel loved whenever they come in here. That's why many of you are still here today. We need to keep that up. Because here's the deal. When you go someplace and all they do is tear you down, do you want to go there? No. You may have to. Maybe it's work. How many of you go to work and all they do is make fun of you and just degrade you? You have to go because you have to. But do you want to be there? No. How often does that happen at church? People go because they have to, but do they really want to be here? No. Are they being encouraged? Maybe it would change if more people would love on them and encourage and build them up instead of making fun of them and tearing them down. No one enjoys going to a place where they get torn down or made fun of or ignored. Early on in my ministry, I do this periodically, but I did this early on in my ministry. I sent out to several people asking for critiques and advice to help me grow as a minister and as a preacher. And one piece of advice I was given about my sermon was this. They said, "Preach biblically positive series. Preach without an axe to grind. Remind them of the promises of God. Assure them of God's character. And tell your church frequently of your love for them." And I will tell you, this piece of advice has stuck with me, not only in my sermons, but in how I minister to people, how I live my life. If I can live this where things are biblically positive, that I'm not looking for an axe to grind, not looking to tear people down, looking for how can I destroy your life, but looking to remind them of God's promises, to assure them of God's character, and telling them how much I love them and how much God loves them, the more I do that, the more blessed I feel. I see God working through things like that, and it is so encouraging. We need to be encouraging each other by telling each other more often that we love each other. By going alongside, and you know what? Sometimes we're going to have tough love. We may have to say, "Hey, you're messing up. Hey, you're slipping up. Hey, you see this? You're starting to swerve. Here's some scripture. Let me spur you back on living like Christ and loving God again. Let me do this for you. Sometimes we're going to have to do that. But we need to do it in a loving way that doesn't tear you down and make you want to go home and cry. A way that builds each other up. When we can do all of those together and encourage each other and use our gifts that God has given us, then we begin to look like the church. And you know what? Then it's no longer a chore. Then you'll see people wanting to be here. When is the church open again? I want to be there. That's what we will see. I want to ask you all a question. Why are you here? And I don't just ask that as, oh, Joey's asking another question. No, I want you to really think about that. Why are you here today? What is your purpose for coming to church? Are you a part of the church? And if you're here and you go, I don't even know what that means, Joey, what does it mean to be a part of the church? Is it just all the things you just said? Well, no, the first thing you've got to do is you've got to be in Christ. Are you a follower of Christ? That's the first part of being a part of his family, is you've got to follow him. Have you said, I believe, I'm ready to repent, I'm going to repent, I want to be baptized, I'm going to follow him completely, and when I receive this forgiveness and the Holy Spirit, I am ready to follow and be a part of his church. If you have not done that yet and you would like to and you want to be a part of this, this sounds something attractive to you, and you go, This is what I've been looking for. Jesus says, I'm ready. I love you enough that I came to die for you. If you want to do that, please come during this song. But I also want to encourage you that if you are here and maybe you've just been coming and you're not really, you've been baptized, you're a follower of Christ, you've repented, but you just, as they say it, a pew warmer or a seat warmer, and you say, I'm ready, I want to be all in. I want to be a part of this church. I want to put my membership in. And when we say that, some go, oh, does this mean you want us to put our membership in and we get deals places or we have to do this, or no. Putting your membership in is basically saying, I want to be an active member of this church and I want everyone to know it. I want to stand up here and tell people I'm ready to be a member. I'm ready to be active in the church, to support and to build up, to encourage people, to use my gifts in the church. If you want to do that today, I encourage you to come and do that also. And if you are a member of this church and you are active, I want to leave us with this one verse before we pray and sing. Romans 15:5-7. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. Let's pray. Dear God, we come right now lifting you up. Lord, glorifying you and thanking you for everything you have blessed us with, Lord. For Christ dying for us, for welcoming us into your family. But Lord, even so much more that you have said, I want you to be a part of my family, and this is what I want my family, the church, to look like. And you have given us support. You've given us encouragement. You've given us people to push us to be more like you. And Lord, you've called us to be that for each other too. I pray, Lord, that if there's anybody here who is not a part of that because they just don't, they've never accepted you, they don't even know what it means to be a part of your family, Lord, I pray you open their hearts and your spirit continues to convict on them, that they may know your love so they can come and follow you. But for the rest of us, Lord, convict us and push us, because Lord, we just don't want to be another church on the street of churches. Just another place where people can walk in, sit down, and walk out. Lord, we want to be the body of Christ. We want to look more like you, that everything we do, how we act and live as a church glorifies you. That people see our church and they see Jesus. Lord, help us to be more like that. Thank you so much. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.